Hi, I'm Stephen and welcome to today's video where we go in search of a BMW i3 to buy for the channel. We're going to start by doing some searches on the internet and especially look out for listings that have errors in them, and you'll see why later. After we've found a couple of interesting cars, we're going to go and have a quick look and a test drive, and I'll show you what I take along on a test drive in order to get as much valuable information about the car as possible in the shortest time. Right, let's get started. The mission is to find a 2017 BMW i3 with a larger 94 amp hour battery, low mileage and some kind of cruise control and heated seats as well. I've heard that some i3s were optioned with a more efficient heat pump heating system, so I wouldn't mind having that too, as it could well increase the vehicle range by a few miles compared to standard resistive heating. That's not really a lot of criteria to search on, but I'm already having some problems. So I'm going to give up on the heat pump heating for now, as the vehicles that have it are way out of budget, and they're also more than 3 hours drive away. The single most important thing in a conventional car is the size of the engine, and it is almost never something you would see listed incorrectly in an advertisement. Nobody would say their car has a V8 engine when it really has a four-cylinder in there. And the same should be the case for battery size in an electric car. But more than half of the BMW i3 advertisements have a non-existent battery size listed. Unbelievable. BMW are partly to blame here by using amp hours instead of kilowatt hours, which nobody else does. However, I still think that the dealers selling these electric cars are either confused or don't care, or both. Well, as a famous car buyer once said, in the midst of chaos, there is also opportunity. Okay, so the quote isn't from a famous car buyer, but you get the idea. What all this means is that if I search for 94 amp hours specifically, that I might be missing the hidden gems, the mislisted entries. So with my new broader search, I came up with a few potential cars, and two of them are from a dealer situated very close to me, which is unusual, but it's great. But the two listings are identical, right down to the number of miles travelled, so it's a bit suspicious. They have no pictures uploaded yet, and have an impossible battery size listed of 39 kilowatt hours. There are only two possible battery sizes for this 2017 car, and they are 22 kilowatts and 33 kilowatt hours. BMW lists these sizes as 60 amp hours and 94 amp hours. Just to be different to everybody else. To top it off, the weather today is absolutely horrible. It's 1 degree above freezing, along with some kind of mushy snow falling out of the sky. So I don't think there could be worse conditions for selling a car, or better conditions for buying one. Should keep the competition down, at least. Well, there's only one way to resolve what's going on with these two strange i3s, and that is to get in the car and go straight to see them. Now, either they've made a mistake and they've listed something twice with incorrect information that they're going to correct later, perhaps, or something else weird is going on, but there's only one way to find out. So I'm going to go there with my bunch of special wet weather equipment, like a special plastic sheet to lie on the ground and inspect the car underneath with. I have my special checklist, which I'll put up on the screen now so you can have a better look at. I have a head torch and a nice bright flashlight. And the most important thing for these computers on wheels is a Autel AP200 Bluetooth OBD2 reader, because we need to know what's going on inside that little computer brain. So we'll see what we get. I'm just coming up to the car dealer now. They won't let me film inside, but hopefully we can get a test drive of one or both of them and see exactly what's going on. See you soon.
In the car lot, it turns out that the car was buried behind about 20 others. So it took quite some time for them to dig it out before I could start the test drive. So it's gotten darker and colder, and now there are only about 30 minutes left until they close for the day. I've got to be super quick about everything from now on. There were in fact two identical i3s that had come in, and each of them does have 16,000 kilometres on the clock. Who'd have thought? However, one of them has a nasty hit to the rear bumper, so I decided to take out the twin that is in better physical condition. I've already done some fast driving, some driving over rough cobblestones and speed humps, some full lock to the left, some full lock to the right, and the car feels solid, rattle and bump free, and it just feels brand new. Super. Now there's a quick trip over some icy potholes, and a quick look over the car, and time to test everything on my checklist. If I can do it in time, wish me luck. I'm not the least bit interested in getting an accident-damaged car, and I don't even want any parking lot scrapes and bumps. So the outside gets a full check over, which is a challenge after driving in the snow and the slush. I'm going to plug in the Autel AP200 so it can be talking to all of the onboard systems while I check the bodywork outside. The i3 has a carbon fibre passenger module, so it is easy and important to check that no repairs have been done. Looks good. The bodywork also looks in great shape. The tyres have about 50% tread left on them, and the alloy wheels are in great condition. All of the interior spaces are virtually unused. You can see more of the carbon fibre frame at the back of the car. And of course, there is even more carbon fibre to check on the right-hand side. Absolutely lovely. And now the plastic sheet comes in handy. The whole floor section is alloy, and it contains the batteries as well as coolant channels to keep them at the right temperature. You really need to make sure that there isn't any physical damage under here. And if you can't check it yourself, or you don't feel confident, then get your mechanic to lift it up and have a good thorough inspection. It's a brave person indeed who would consider buying any electric car without checking this underbody area, as any damage could cost you $10,000 plus. A quick check of any other damage and then it's on to the inside of the car. Climate control. Check. Heated seats? What? Where are the heated seats? Is it even legal to sell a BMW without heated seats? That's a huge minus. And it was all going so well. Automatic wipers. They weren't mentioned. A bonus. Check. Cruise control. Check. Windows. Check. Locks. Check. Mirrors. Check. Bluetooth. Check. Electric parking brake. Check. I wonder if you can drift with an electric parking brake. Anyway, parking sensors. Check. Sat-nav. Check. Servicing up to date. Check. Fog lights. Check. Leather steering wheel. Check. Media center. Check. Cup holders. Check. All lights inside and out. Check. And check. Turn signals. Can't find them. Doesn't matter. If you want this electric car buying checklist, then you can find it in the video description. Right, I've got to get this car back. Next we'll look at what the VIN check reveals and what the Autel AP200 has found out from its talk with the i3's computers. I put in the car's vehicle identification number into the VIN checking website, bimmer.work, and they turned up the following useful information about this particular i3. It has the 94 amp hour or 33 kilowatt hour battery that I'd hoped for. But what is really surprising is that it also is optioned with this heat pump heating, which is quite an expensive option, and one that I was definitely hoping to get on an i3. A heat pump is, in essence, a different name for reverse cycle air conditioning, which is a much more efficient way to heat an electric car compared to running electricity directly through a wire coil, which is called resistive heating. In super cold Norway, there was some testing done and they found that normal resistive heating caused a 25% reduction in a car's range, whereas heat pump at the same temperature caused a 10% reduction. That is quite substantial, so you can probably understand why this is a useful feature to have. So the real question for me is whether the heat pump makes up for the lack of heated seats. Some thinking for me to do while we look at the diagnostic results. So let's open up the Autel AP200 app and see what it has recorded in the repair report. The car thinks it was born November 2016, which doesn't conflict with it being a 2017 car, and it is listed as a 94 model, which means that it has the 94 amp hour, 33 kilowatt hour battery, which is what I want. If we look at the history section of the AP200 app, then there are a number of DTCs, which is diagnostic trouble codes, but none of them are recent. So either they occurred as a result of things being unplugged during the service, or are things that have been repaired, so hopefully nothing much to worry about. Fingers crossed. The DTCs don't open up further in this history section because the AP200 is no longer connected to the car, of course. But if there was something concerning, then I could have saved it to look at it later. It is worth noting that no DTC, no trouble codes have ever been deleted on this car. So the full history is laid out there for me to see, which is sort of nice. If you ever check a car and it has no DTCs, then it is pretty obvious that they have been deleted. But it isn't at all obvious how recently that might have been. It could have been half an hour before you took the test drive. Or 5 minutes. So what do you think? Should I buy this car for the channel, even though it doesn't have heated seats? So that I'm forced to do a video on how to retrofit heated seats? Or maybe you have another type of BMW in mind that I should get. Or maybe get as well. Let me know in the comments below, as I would love to hear from you. Until next time.